started a series last week called Countdown to the Cradle. And so we are dealing with some of the messages leading up to the miracle of Christ's birth. And so we're really excited about that. We're going to continue with that theme on today. So if you have your Bible, I want you to turn with me to Luke chapter 1. And last week we looked at Luke chapter 1. We looked at the story of Zacharias and his wife Elizabeth. And today we want to go a little bit further, and we want to look at verse number 26. So if you would stand with me for the reading of God's word, Luke chapter 1, starting at verse number 26. Amen. Luke chapter 1, starting at verse number 26. It says, "Now in the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to the city of Galilee named Nazareth, to a virgin betrothed to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary. And having come in, the angel said to her, 'Rejoice, highly favored one, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women.' But when she saw him, she was troubled at his saying and considered what manner of greeting this was. Then the angel said to her, 'Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And behold, you will conceive in your womb, and you will bring forth a son, and shall call his name Jesus. And he will be great, and he will be called the Son of the Highest, and of the Lord God will give him the throne of his father David. And he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his house there will be no end.' And Mary said to the angel, 'How can this be, since I do not know a man?' And the angel answered and said to her, 'The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Highest will overshadow you. Therefore, that Holy One who is to be born will be called the Son of God. Now indeed, Elizabeth, your relative, also has conceived a son in her old age, and this is now the sixth month for her who was called barren. For with God, nothing will be impossible.' Then Mary said, 'Behold, the maidservant of the Lord, let it be to me according to your word.' And the angel departed from her." Amen. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Today, I want to talk for a few moments from this subject, an unexpected pregnancy. An unexpected pregnancy. In our society, it is not uncommon to see pregnant women. And oftentimes, whether she's married or unmarried, you may hear her utter the words, "This was an unexpected pregnancy." In other words, the pregnancy was not planned, it was not organized, it was not scheduled around an ovulation cycle, but the pregnancy literally came as a surprise to her as well as the baby's father. And even though pregnancies which happen under this circumstance can be unexpected and unnerving, couples understand that there's a risk of pregnancy whenever you have an intimate encounter. And let's be honest, there are women who've had unexpected pregnancies and were sad about it. Perhaps she was sad because she was not ready to deal with the financial obligations of a child. Maybe she was sad because she was connected she was not ready to be connected to the child's father for the next 18 years. Perhaps she was sad because she was not ready to sacrifice her short-term dreams, goals, and ambitions in order to raise a child. However, for others, an unexpected pregnancy can be a joyous occasion. Why? Because they realize that this child is a blessing from the Lord. Not only is it a blessing, but it's an opportunity to rear this child in the fear and admonition of the Lord. I bring this up, ladies and gentlemen, because as we look at our text for the morning, we're going to see a woman named Mary. And Mary had an unexpected pregnancy. But instead of her being sad about it, Mary chose to rejoice over it. Because to her, this child represented her receiving a blessing from the Lord. As a matter of fact, in verse 30, the angel Gabriel appears to Mary, and he tells her that she's going to give birth to the Messiah, this long-awaited Savior of Israel. And he lets her know that the birth of this child will be supernatural and that her fiance Joseph will not be the biological father. As a matter of fact, Mary was informed in verse 35 that the Holy Spirit will come upon her and cause her to become pregnant. Now, I don't know how she broke this news to Joseph, but somewhere in the conversation, she must have mentioned God and baby daddy. Come on, somebody. I find it interesting that while the angel Gabriel is talking to Mary, he uses some significant terms to describe her. In verse 28, he calls her highly favored. In verse 28, he also calls her blessed among women. In verse 30, the angel says she's found favor with God. In a real sense, this unexpected pregnancy was God's way of showering Mary with divine favor. And it's important that I let you know this because God is waiting to give you an unexpected pregnancy. Now, I know I just lost about 25 men, but I'm not talking about God giving you an unexpected baby. I'm talking about God giving you an unexpected blessing. You see, like Mary, each of us should desire to be favored by God. Now, I know what you're saying, Pastor. What is favor? In order to understand what favor is, it's important that we understand what favor is not. Favor is not grace. Grace is the unmerited blessing of God. It's when God gives you what you don't deserve. Think about it. None of us deserve to go to heaven, all the sinful stuff that we've done in life. But the reason we're on our way there is because of the grace of God. God extends to us what we don't deserve. Favor is not mercy. Mercy is when God holds back from you what you do deserve. Keep it 100. Some of you deserve to have about 3 or 4 STDs, all the wild stuff you did in your 20s. Look at y'all getting quiet. Some of you deserve to be incarcerated in prison, all the illegal stuff you did in life. Some of you deserve to be strung out, pacing back and forth in front of a dope house, all the stuff you experimented with in the past. But the reason you're in church this morning, clean, free, and in your right mind, is because of the mercy of God. God held back from you what you deserve. Y'all, favor is not grace, nor is it mercy. Rather, favor is when God blesses you in response to your faithfulness to Him. In a real sense, favor is the tangible evidence that a person has the approval of God. Y'all, this is not good luck. This is not good fortune. This is not happenstance. But this is God intentionally pouring out His goodness on your life. Listen, every one of us in here ought to want the favor of God. You see, somebody once said, God's favor is worth more than a lifetime of labor. In other words, you can go to school, you can climb the corporate ladder of success, you can receive all the stellar rewards in the world, but someone with favor will still beat you out for the position. Why? Because favor isn't fair. Favor is what I call right privilege. I need to spell it for some of you radicals. Favor is right privilege, R-I-G-H-T. Listen, when you decide to do right, when you decide to live right, when you decide to talk and walk right, you will receive right privilege. This is when God allows you to prosper and produce in whatever environment that you find yourself in. If you find yourself in the projects, He'll prosper you there. If you find yourself in a prison cell, He'll prosper you there. If you find yourself at a racist, sexist job, He can prosper you there. As a matter of fact, somebody just shout, He'll prosper you there. Yeah, He'll prosper you there. He'll prosper you there. Your family may be dysfunctional, but He'll prosper you there. Your marriage may feel dead or dying, but He'll prosper you there. You may think you've got to leave Lafayette in order to be successful, but God said He'll prosper you there. Because when the favor of God is on your life, whatever you touch will prosper. I know what you're saying. Pastor, how do I position myself to receive the favor of God? The answer is found in Proverbs chapter 12, verse number 2. Watch what it says. Proverbs 12 and 2. It says, a good man obtains favor from the Lord, but a man of wicked intentions He will condemn. There it is. A good man obtains favor from the Lord. Listen, it's important to understand that being good would not get you into heaven. We're not saved by good deeds, but we're saved by God's grace through faith in Jesus Christ. However, when we live according to the word of God, when we display a heart of goodness toward others, the promise of God is that we will receive his favor. But if you're living your life outside of God's will, if you're mean, messy, and malicious, if you're trying to grow marijuana in your backyard, if you're going to the strip club every other Friday, pocket full of ones, don't expect to receive the favor of God. No, you're on your own. And I don't know about you, but I don't want to be on my own in order to be successful. I don't want to rely on my skill and ability. I don't want to rely on my education and ingenuity to get ahead. I want the favor of God, because I've discovered that God's favor will always take you further in life. Okay, y'all didn't get it. They didn't get it, Deacon Young. I got to come down and impress it upon you that God's favor will always take you further. See, some of us right now, we think that in order to go further in life, I got to be connected to the AKAs, and I got to be connected to the Deltas, and I got to be connected to Sigma Gamma Rho. And then some of you think that in order to go further, you got to be connected to the Kappas or the Qs. And then some of you think that in order for me to achieve a level of greatness, I got to be connected to the Masons or the Eastern Star. Look, it's all getting quiet. And then some of you think that in order for me to get ahead, I got to go back to college and get my degree. I got to get my master's degree. I got to get my PhD. Listen, I'm not knocking education, but I want you to know something. You can give me grace. You can give me the favor of God. I'll take the favor of God over a PhD any day. Because listen, I know a whole lot of folk that got a lot of education and they can still fall flat on their face. But when you got the favor of God on your life, he'll open doors for you. When you got the favor of God on your life, he'll propel you to greatness. When you got the favor of God on your life, he'll cause the HR manager to pull your resume. When you got the favor of God on your life, God will send customers to your business. When you got the favor of God on your life, God will cause the company to hire you, and they're on a hiring freeze. Why? Because when you got the favor of God, he will give you blessing running over. Is there anybody in here that wants the favor of God? Don't fool me. Is there anybody that wants the favor of God? Y'all, Mary, this teenage girl, had the favor of God on her life. And I wanted to know why she was favored by God. What was it about Mary that allowed her to receive this unexpected blessing from the Lord? And I discovered that the reason why she received this unexpected blessing, number one, it's getting ready to get deep. It's tight, but it's right. First reason she received this unexpected blessing, number one, y'all ready? Because she was willing to control her urges. It's in the text. Look at verse number 27. To a virgin, betrothed to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary. Here we find Mary betrothed or engaged to be married to a man named Joseph. And in this verse, there's a word used twice to describe Mary that we don't hear very often in our culture. That word is virgin. In other words, Mary had never been with a man sexually. And if I had time, I would ask the question, what happened to all the virgins? What happened to all the sisters like Mary who committed themselves to remaining sexually pure until marriage? You see, Mary knew how to wait. She knew how to control her hormones and not allow her hormones to control her. And I'm talking to somebody right now. And your hormones always seem to get the best of you. Hear me clearly. If you're a child of God, you shouldn't be engaging in white one-night stands. Look at y'all getting quiet. If you're a child of God, you shouldn't be engaging in the examination of erotic content. If you're a child of God, you shouldn't be engaging in late-night rendezvous at the Ramada Inn. Something in you ought to say, this mess is wrong, and I will not drag the Holy Spirit in me into my dark, twisted fantasy. Listen, I'm sure that there were times where Mary considered experimenting. But her love for God and her respect for God's word caused her to keep those urges in check. Let me show you something. Look at Proverbs chapter 25, verse number 28. Watch what it says. It says, a person without self-control is like a city with broken down walls. Here Solomon likens a lack of self-control to a city with broken down walls. You see, in ancient times, having walls around the city was its primary defense from attack. It was difficult, sometimes impossible, for the enemy to conquer a city that had fortified walls around it. However, if it was discovered that there was a breach, a crack or opening in the wall, the enemy would do everything in their power to enter the city through that broken wall. I bring this up, ladies and gentlemen, because some of us have broken walls in our lives. The enemy can come and go as he pleases. Every nasty and negative thought that the enemy plants in your mind, you entertain it. There are no barriers and boundaries in your life. There's no attempt, effort, or strategy to live a life of purity before God. Proverbs 4 and 23 says, above all else, guard your heart, for everything you do flows from it. Hear me, people of God, we've got to guard our minds. We've got to guard what we allow to enter our ear gate and our eye gate. Hello, somebody, because I'm convinced that the more you listen to violent music, the more violent of a person you'll become. I'm convinced that the more you hang around people that curse, the more you'll find yourself cursing. Hello, somebody. The more you watch overly sexualized content, the more you'll find yourself deep thinking dirty thoughts throughout the day. That's why as Christians, we should guard what we allow to enter into our space. We ought to have some sort of standard, and that standard ought to be based on the word of God. You see, if you have a standard, you won't watch just anything. If you have a standard, you won't go to just any type of party. If you have a standard, you won't date just any type of person. Why? Because you have a standard. And when you have a standard, you'll know exactly what to say no to. You'll say no to getting involved in illegal activity. You'll say no to getting drunk at the family reunion. You'll say no to him spending the night over your house. You'll say no to overspending just because the item is on sale. Oh, I know I lost about 20 sisters right there. I mean, here you are. You've never met a sale that you didn't like, and you know you needed to save that money, but that dress, look at y'all getting quiet, them shoes, that purse kept calling your name, and what did you do? You took out that credit card and you swiped it, and even if you didn't have a credit card, you opened one up just to get the 10% discount. And by the time you finally pay off that outfit, you will have spent $280 on a $150 purchase. Y'all, it's something wrong with that. And it's all because you did not control your urges. Oh, I know I'm telling the truth. Some of you right now, you struggle with that. Because you went to the store to buy one item, some detergent. And next thing you know, you coming out with a full shopping cart of stuff. Look at y'all getting quiet because you don't know how to control your urges. Y'all, Mary, she was a virgin. When the angel said she was gonna give birth to the Messiah. Her first response was, how can this be since I do not know a man? Y'all, Mary was a true virgin. I bring this up because too many Christians are acting like they can backdate their virginity. Talking about you a virgin again. I hate to bust your bubble, but that's not something you can reverse. You can't jump in a time machine and go back to the scene of the crime. But what you can do is say, starting today, I'm going to live a life of purity. Starting today, I'm going to save myself until marriage. But here's the sad and unfortunate reality. Many believers are attempting to redefine what marriage is in order to justify having sex. Oh, is this too deep for a Christmas message? So they say things like, it's okay to be sexually active because we're engaged. They say things like, it's okay to be sexually active because we're in a committed relationship. We've been together 5+ years. Listen, I don't care if you've been together for 25 years. If there's no wedding ring on your finger, you should abstain from sexual immorality if you want the favor of God on your life. Y'all, Mary did it God's way. And because she did it God's way, she was proposed to by a good man. Because Mary did it God's way, she was chosen by God to carry the Messiah. Because Mary did it God's way, she was given an unexpected blessing from the Lord. Y'all, this is what favor looks like. You just going through life, minding your own business, obeying God, when suddenly, unexpectedly, God begins to bless your life. Y'all, that's what I want. I want the favor of God. I want to be going through life, doing my own thing, and all of a sudden, God sends an unexpected check in the mail. All of a sudden, God opens the door that I don't know how it happened, but God said, I'm just going to pour it out on you. Oh, I love unexpected stuff. James, I got a summons last week, said I got to go to jury duty. Jury duty. I hated that. I hated I even saw it. But you know what? You know what the favor of God will do? Friday, I got a text message from the government said that jury duty's been canceled. Hello, somebody. Hallelujah. That's what you call favor right there. Listen, Mary received an unexpected blessing, not only because she was willing to control her urges, but secondly, she was willing to consent to being used. It's in the text. Look at verse 38. It says, then Mary said, behold, the maidservant of the Lord, let it be according to your word. And the angel departed from her. Here we find that Mary has a willingness to take on the responsibility of carrying the Messiah. And what's interesting is that most people would have had an incomplete understanding of the coming Messiah. You see, they thought that the Messiah would be a military leader who would eventually overthrow the Roman government. This is why King Herod was so intent on killing the baby Jesus that he ordered all Jewish males under 2 to be executed, because he believed that this Messiah would one day overthrow his throne or the throne of his son. I bring this up because most Jews believed that the Messiah would be an ordinary man, that he was not going to be the God-man. Apparently, they didn't realize Isaiah 9:6, which talks about the Messiah being called Mighty God and Everlasting Father, which speaks to his divinity. This is significant because most women would have desired to be the mother of the Messiah until they realized what it entailed. You see, accepting this assignment would have put Mary in a bad spot. Why? Because she knew she ran the risk of losing her relationship with Joseph, because Joseph may have very well decided to end the engagement and expose her to public humiliation. She knew that she ran the risk of losing her family, because the revelation of infidelity would have been such a stain on the family that it may have permanently caused them to distance themselves from her. She knew that she ran the risk of losing her very life, because under Old Testament law, if a person was caught in adultery, both the adulterer and the adulteress were to be put to death. So Mary's willingness to be used by God should never be understated or underestimated. She was willing to risk it all in order to be used by God. Think about it. She was faced with the very real possibility of receiving ridicule and rejection by her own Jewish contemporaries. But I like Mary because even though she had these obstacles staring her in the face, she didn't allow those difficulties to deter her. We know this because in verse 31, she says to the angel, let it be to me according to your word. And I wonder how many of us would have responded the way Mary did. I mean, if God had given you an assignment and you knew that by taking it, you would be labeled a fornicator. You knew that by taking it, you would be labeled an adulterer. I wonder how many of us would have said yes to that assignment. You see, my fear is that too many believers are taking a pass when it comes to fulfilling the purpose that God has for their life. And they're saying, Lord, I'll pass. I'll pass on serving in ministry. I'll pass on witnessing to the lost. I'll pass on financially supporting the church. I'll pass on donating my time and energy to some spiritual cause. And oftentimes, the reason they pass is because they don't want to deal with the risk. As a matter of fact, there are people in here right now who won't serve in ministry because you don't want to risk being asked to do more. You don't want to risk getting involved in something that you may not like. There are people in here right now who will pass on inviting, passing out invite flyers in the community because they don't want to risk getting rained on. Don't want to risk getting their hair wet. Don't want to risk getting chased by a dog. Don't want to risk having a door slammed in their face. There are people in here right now who won't give to the local church because they don't want to risk being short on a bill. Don't want to risk needing the money and not having it. Don't want to risk not having enough to buy your sister a Christmas gift. And as a result, they have no problem telling the Lord, I'll pass. And I wonder how many of you just this year have told the Lord, find somebody else to do it. Oh, I know you would never say it verbally, but you say it every time you refuse to be used by God. Listen, God wants me to let somebody know that he loves you so much that even though there are times when you passed on him, he has never passed on you. Because when you were in the hospital, he still came to see about you. When you were driving under the influence, he still made sure you got home safely. When you were broke and didn't have a dime to your name, he still made sure you had food to eat. When you were about to have a nervous breakdown, he came through and he eased your troubled mind. When you were heartbroken over the death of a loved one, he gave you peace and he wiped your tears away. And I wonder, is there anybody in here who can thank God for never passing on you? Friends may have passed on you. Family members may have passed on you. Church folk may have passed on you. But God has never passed on you. That's why the old saints used to say, pass me not, O gentle Savior. Hear my humble cry. While all others that were calling, do not pass me by. Listen, if God doesn't pass on serving us, we should not pass on serving him. Amen, somebody. Listen, Mary received an unexpected blessing. Number one, because she was willing to control her urges. She received an unexpected blessing because she was willing to consent to being used. And lastly, she received an unexpected blessing because she was willing to conceive and carry Christ. Look at verse 31. Watch what it says. It says, and behold, you will conceive in your womb and bring forth a son and shall call his name Jesus. Listen, the word conceive literally means to become pregnant. Hear me clearly. When God's favor is on your life, he will allow you to become pregnant with possibilities. In other words, God will impregnate you with dreams, visions, and strategies. He'll impregnate you with books, business concepts, and movie ideas. He'll impregnate you with ministry, mission fields, and marketing ideas because he's got something great on the inside of you. And what God has conceived in you was never meant to stay in you. It was always meant to come out of you. You see, God wants to use what is in you to be a blessing to the masses. But the sad reality is that too many people will die with the baby still in their womb. They'll die never giving birth to the idea, never giving birth to the invention, never giving birth to the investment that they were intended to bring forth. Y'all, God wants to use what he put inside of you to change the trajectory of your life. But we need faith to see it become a reality. I'm reminded of Joseph, not the Joseph engaged to Mary, but the Joseph in the Old Testament. If you recall, God had given Joseph a dream, a vision of him ruling over his family. However, Joseph unwisely told his older brothers of this dream. And in a jealous fit of rage, they beat their brother up and they sold him into slavery. However, while he was a slave at Potiphar's house, God's favor caused him to run the entire estate. And even when he was falsely accused of an assault and sent to prison, God's favor caused him to run the entire prison yard. And if you keep on reading, you'll discover that after he was released from prison, the favor of God caused him to ascend to second in command in Egypt. Don't miss this. God planted the vision. Joseph did the producing, but God doubled back around and did the prospering. Y'all missed it. God gave Joseph the vision. Joseph did the producing, but God did the prospering. Listen, I don't know who I'm talking to this morning, but somebody needs to know that when God's favor is on your life, he will plant the idea in your heart, but you got to do the producing. You got to create the business plan. You got to purchase the startup equipment. You got to work towards your goal. And once you do the producing, God will do the prospering. The old saying used to say it like this: if you take one step, he will do the rest. Because when God's favor is on your life, you will conceive. As a matter of fact, somebody shout, I will conceive. The devil wants you to believe that God is finished with you. The devil wants you to believe that God no longer has a purpose for your life. The devil wants you to believe that God has wiped his celestial hands of you. But nothing could be further from the truth. The fact of the matter is this: if you practice obedience, if you participate in service, it won't be long before God elevates you. It won't be long before God allows you to see the fruits of your labor. It won't be long before God takes you from faith to faith and glory to glory. But you got to do like Joseph and keep the faith. You got to keep the faith in dark times. You got to keep the faith when people hurt you. You got to keep the faith when people are lying on your name. Because after a while, what is conceived in you will eventually come out of you. And when your haters see you at your book signing, when they see you running the department, when they see you cutting the ribbon at your grand opening, don't you dare lift up your head in pride. When they ask you how you did it, you tell them God made a way. When they ask you how you did it, you tell them God opened the door. When they ask you how you did it, say God supplied all my needs according to his riches and glory. Can I get a witness in here? This is my assignment this morning. It's to let you know that as long as you've got the favor of God, you can do anything that you put your mind to. As a matter of fact, the Bible says with God, watch this, all things are possible. How many of you know that we serve a God that has no limitations? Oh, his power is unmatched. His strength is unparalleled. His presence is undeniable. And as long as you remain connected to him, he can cause you to do the impossible. He can cause you to achieve what people said you would fail at. He will cause you to accomplish things that nobody else in your family was able to accomplish. But you got to first be willing to position yourself to receive the favor of God. I'm done. But I got to leave you with this one last thing, and we out of here. One last thing. Look at verse 39. And we done. Verse 39. Watch what it says. It says, Mary, this is just overtime. This is for free. It says, now Mary arose in those days and went to the hill country with haste to a city of Judah, and entered the house of Zacharias and greeted Elizabeth. And it happened when Elizabeth heard the greeting of Mary that the babe leaped in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. Listen, Mary has just found out that she's been chosen to be the mother of the Messiah. And one of the first things that she does is that she goes to the house of her cousin Elizabeth. And Elizabeth was pregnant with the baby John the Baptist. And the Bible says that when Elizabeth opened the door, Mary greeted her. And when Elizabeth heard the greeting of Mary, the Bible says that the baby leaped in her womb.
Now, somehow this baby had enough sense to know that it was in the presence of a king. And the baby began to celebrate right in its mother's womb. And here's what's crazy. The baby celebrated before it ever had a relationship with Jesus. Jesus never got the baby out of a jam. Jesus never helped the baby pay a bill. Jesus never healed the baby of a sickness. Jesus never provided the baby with a job. And yet the baby still leaped in the presence of a king. And I bring this up because if we believe that our King is present, we ought to praise his holy name. I said, if we believe our King is present, we ought to give him some glory. If we believe our King is present, we ought to magnify his holy name. David said, oh, magnify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together. I bring this up because if you know the King is present, you ought to give him the glory. I don't know about you, but I refuse to be out praised by an unborn baby because I've got history with the Lord. He's been my provider. He's been my sustainer. He's been my deliverer. He's been my redeemer. He's been my strong tower. I know it's at least 18 of you who can look back over your life and say only the Lord could have done that. Only the Lord could have kept us together. Only the Lord could have healed my body. Only the Lord could have opened that door. Only the Lord could have delivered my child. I'm sorry, but if a baby can leap for a Jesus that it doesn't know, you ought to celebrate a Jesus that you do know. Is there anybody who can testify that I know him? Oh, I know him, I know him, I know him. I know him as a heart fixer. I know him as a mind regulator. I know him as a doctor in a sick room. I know him as a lawyer in a courtroom. I know him as bread when I'm hungry, water when I'm thirsty, a friend that's sticking closer than a brother. I don't know about you, but I got a reason to bless the Lord. I got a reason to magnify his name because he's been good to me. I said he's been good to me. I said he's been good to me. Can anybody testify he's been good to you? The Bible says the Lord is good and his mercy endureth to all generations. Y'all, we got a reason to give God glory today. Y'all receive it today? Amen. Let's give God a hand of praise.